It's been just over a decade since Indonesia became a fully functioning democracy. Now it's gearing up for its second only direct presidential elections. But with the three main candidates all holdovers from the Suharto era, there are concerns this nation may not have matured politically. I'm Fauzia Ibrahim. In this edition of 101 East, we ask if Indonesia can make a clean break from its political past. The candidates contesting in Indonesia's presidential polls are all familiar faces. The incumbent president, Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono, is up against his own vice president, Yusuf Kalla, and also former president Megawati Sukarnoputri. Voters will make their decisions based not only on the candidates' policies, but also their personalities, loyalty, ethnicity, and religion. We take a look now at the 2009 Indonesian presidential polls.
Indonesians have long equated national politics with wayang kulit, the traditional art of shadow puppetry. They say these ancient stories mirror the intrigue, schemes, and plots involved in winning political power. One legend tells the story of an honorable hero who battles evil and brings glory to Indonesia. Many believe the hero is incumbent President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono. Yudhoyono's popularity has grown since he was elected 5 years ago. He is seen by many as a trusty father figure, comforting the nation during the 2004 tsunami, overseeing the Aceh Peace Agreement, and effectively cracking down on corruption. Under Yudhoyono, the nation has enjoyed the strongest economic growth in a decade, even growing 6% despite a global recession. But it is his populist programs that have won him the most applause from Indonesians.
After these 10 years of reformation of this democracy era, they have not seen a government that have a program that directly affect them. Now, Yudhoyono's programs, you know, and the direct assistance, all of those populist policies and programs have a direct impact on their lives. It's the assistance for the poor villages, promoting further on free education, free health services. I think that makes him a very, very popular president.
Yudhoyono hopes to ride on his popularity for re-election on July 8th. He's chosen central bank governor and former finance minister Budiono as his running mate. While observers say the pairing bodes well for the nation's economy, neither are up to breaking through Indonesia's systemic bureaucracy.
The work mechanism between these two is certainly not a problem. What will become our concern is when you have to enforce, because these two is known to be very polite, you know, in a country like this, sometimes you must be aggressive, yeah. to get things done.
It's a complaint that has plagued Yudhoyono's term and something his current vice president, Yusuf Kalla, hopes to capitalize on.
Insyaallah, Indonesia bisa menjadi bangsa yang maju dan mandiri.
Kalla has teamed up with former military general Wiranto, promising a government that delivers faster and better. Both are seen as strong nationalist leaders who may force the presidential polls into a second round. Even Wiranto's questionable human rights record during his term in East Timor hasn't dampened the support for this pairing.
You know, the economic issues have become the primary issue. It is not the human rights issue. I would say human rights have become the least prioritized one, particularly for the poor, which is the majority of the voters.
Pemerintah bilang ekonomi baik-baik saja, ternyata di desa tidak.
Memang buat mereka yang diam di gedung tinggi, kalau buat saya untuk beli susu aja susah.
Nggak ada pupuk, nggak ada irigasi, kebanyakan petani miskin, kami kayak seperti nggak ada.
And it is this large group of poor voters that former President Megawati Sukarnoputri is trying to appeal to. Her presidential campaign ad points to the failings of the current government, accusing them of not doing enough to reduce poverty and unemployment. Her running mate is Prabowo Subianto, another former military general with a record of alleged human rights abuse. Some observers say this team is built on fulfilling their own interests rather than those of the nation.
The interest of Megawati is, of course, the fact that she has to satisfy her loyalists. You know, about 10 to 15% of the Indonesian voters wants her to run. But she understands that she's not going to win. So she doesn't want to, you know, spend resources. And, you know, now she has Prabowo, who has the resources, and also who has the interest to put himself in the Indonesian political map. It's some kind of, what, rehabilitation process for him. A lot of allegations regarding human rights violations on him. Prabowo is eyeing for 2014, it's not now. And to be able to run effectively in 2014, he has to put himself on the map and rehabilitate his name.
The three main presidential candidates are all part of Indonesia's political history, all having served during the Suharto era. But critics say it is this old guard regime that's holding back the rise of Indonesia's younger leaders and ultimately the nation's progress.
Yudi Krisnandi knows only too well the struggle to be recognized as a political leader. At age 41, he tried to run in this year's presidential race, but was not supported by his own Golkar party.
In Indonesian political system, as everybody knows, that oligarchy party is very, very tightened. For the senior politician, if they have still a chance come to power, they will try for themselves, not give a chance to the young generation.
But Krisnandi is not giving up the fight, and he's confident of his chances for the next presidential polls in 2014.
This is the last battle for the old soldier, because only this period, the chance for them, they are influenced by the corruption morality from the previous situation, previous government. When my generation appeared, 2014, my generation untouched from the Suharto era. We are more independent. We are more freely to make a decision for our nation. We have no burden from the old period. We can see more freely and more clearly about our future of Indonesia.
But until such time, Indonesians will have to continue to watch the shadow puppetry of the nation's politics. The next president will have to maneuver through the complexities of coalitions, political partnerships, and party loyalties, all the while battling evil in any form to become the nation's savior.
Joining me to discuss the issues of Indonesia's presidential elections, I'm joined from Jakarta by political analyst Jacqueline Hicks and Bara Hasibuan, a member of incumbent President Susilo Bambang Yudhoyono's campaign team. Thank you very much for joining us, both of you. Jacqueline Hicks, if I can start with you. We've seen Yudhoyono's track record. Indonesia has seen the longest period of political stability under him, the best economic growth in a decade. He ended the longest running war in Southeast Asia in Aceh. But what do you think are his weaknesses as a leader?
Well, he's running on a platform of anti-corruption, but really he still has yet to do any real solid work with in terms of bureaucratic reform or even getting systematically into anti-corruption reform. He still has a lot of work to go there.
And Bara, would you agree that these are the fields in which Yudhoyono has to improve, at least in the next 5 years, if he does get re-elected?
Yes, I agree with that. There's a lot of work remains to be done in the second term. I think bureaucratic reform is just one of the challenges if Yudhoyono gets re-elected for the second term. And of course, we still have a lot of work to do in terms of the war on corruption. For sure, we've made a lot of progress in terms of our effort in combating corruption. But I think a lot of work remains to be done.
Yeah, there's been some progress made, but no real systematic efforts. Another thing that I wanted to mention as well was in terms of human rights. The president has not done brilliantly. There has been, for example, this issue of the volcanic, the mud well that erupted over 3 years ago now, displacing tens of thousands of people. And it was a company owned by one of SBY's cabinet members. And up until now, there's still been no real resolution of that. And SBY has been criticized a lot for that.
But that is a long-time complaint of SBY during his term as president, the fact that nothing seems to be getting done, or if it does get done, it's very slow. Wouldn't you agree with Bara Hasibuan?
Well, I have to disagree with that. I think when looking at an issue, the president tends to look at a number of different perspectives before making any decision. But when it comes to the time to make decision, he makes the decision. For instance, when the government had to raise the fuel prices because the subsidies were getting higher, were getting unbearable, when the right time came, the president made the decision to cut the subsidies and raise the fuel prices. And when you look at the peace process in Aceh also, at the end, the president made the decision to negotiate with the Free Aceh Movement, despite the fact that there was a lot of resistance in Jakarta.
We're going to have to leave it there for just a moment, and I will pick up on that point. Coming up after the break, we hear from the supporters of the three candidates for Indonesia's presidential elections. Stay with 101 East.